Welcome to this edition of Excavating the Bible, a program dedicated to exploring the contributions that Middle Eastern archaeologists make to our understanding of and appreciation for the Bible. I'm Doug Clark. I direct the Center for Near Eastern Archaeology, La Sierra University, along with two colleagues, Dr. Larry Geraty, Dr. Camp Bramlett. Larry is a former president at La Sierra. Kent is a professor in the Divinity School. And we have been thinking about and walking together through the Bible, book by book, thinking about archaeological connections. And we've taken a kind of a break to think about the time between the Testaments. And we've talked a bit about the challenges of moving from the Old Testament world to the New Testament world in a time period we call the Greek period or the Hellenistic period. But we shift now to the Roman period. Just kind of off the top of your head, what does it mean to be thinking Roman Empire? What does it mean to be thinking the Roman period archaeologically?
One thinks of course, the imperial might of, of the Roman military. But what is also striking is that everywhere the Roman Empire expanded, you find a set of features which identified the Roman sense of self. So you have, of course, theaters, you have bathhouses, you have homes that are the same style, Mediterranean courtyard homes all the way up into, you know, England. Doesn't really fit the environment there, but that was what it meant to be a Roman. You had to have that kind of house. So we have this set of cultural ideas that are expressed in artifacts, and we find those from the eastern side through to the western
side. So architecture and artifacts, both are good lenses through which to find out something more about Roman culture.
We think of laws too, don't we, with Rome? I mean, they had a legal system that spread throughout the Mediterranean world.
Right. Now, we will be thinking through this episode as we look at the Mediterranean world. We'll look at Palestine in our next episode, but looking at the entire Mediterranean world, we will be thinking about architecture. We will be thinking about some of inscriptions that we might find, as well as artifacts. Hopefully, to create a sense of the world into which the New Testament was born, and in which New Testament characters, which do stretch around, certainly around the northern Mediterranean, where they lived and how they lived. And it might be, I think we've all kind of assumed this and said this and tried to demonstrate it. It might be that by paying attention to what archaeology can tell us, we could read the New Testament with a greater understanding. So, at least that's our goal. So let's look at some artifacts first of all. We don't have as many on the table as sometimes we do, but many of them are different from what we've seen before. Kent, begin with what is in front of you. What do we have in this metal piece?
Well, it doesn't pose much of a challenge to most people when they look at it. They say, wow, that looks like a door knocker. That's what it was. In fact, it would be stylish on any fine, large door today. But it's late Roman, so approaching 2,000 years old. And that's an example. Actually, there are quite a few of these that have been recovered archaeologically. And it's one of those items which really hasn't changed that much down through the ages.
We might want to think about that as we come to New Testament passages dealing with opening doors, entering people's houses and so on, and knocking on the door. Could be very illustrative. Okay, Kent, I think you have an inscription there too, and then Larry's going to do the sculpture over here.
Well, this is a nice brick. Roman bricks were very different than the Iron Age Old Testament bricks that we dig up in our excavations in Jordan. The Roman bricks were thin, small, and they stacked them. We can spot them right off. But what's interesting about this brick is that it has a stamped impression on it that identifies it as belonging to construction works of the 10th Legion. And that's significant because it was the 10th Legion under Vespasian's control initially, and then Titus, that was camped up on Mount Scopus, sort of the northern extent of the Mount of Olives, where they eventually took Jerusalem during the Roman capture of Jerusalem in 70 AD.
Right, right. Larry.
I don't know very much about Roman statuary, but it's interesting that the hair is similar to hairdos that you find today, isn't mm-hmm. it? And the nose has sort of disappeared, but a nice stone example of
a
headless statue.
Now, yeah. we have lots of heads. Mm-hmm. Why don't we have them attached? Why are they?
Why not the bodies?
Are they broken off, or are they accidentally broken, or?
Well, the neck is the weak point, if you think structurally mm-hmm. on a statue, along with wrists right. and things. So if the statue falls down in an earthquake or in another destruction, likely the head's going to pop off. Mm-hmm. But also, souvenir hunters in the past, and again in the present, go for heads because that's easy to transport and easy to resell. It's much harder to take the whole body.
Right.
Of course, busts were popular in ancient times, true. Just as they are today. So sometimes they came without the body.
And we will actually see some pictures mm-hmm. of busts mm-hmm. of Roman emperors. This one is tilted a bit because of the difficulty, given its weight, uh-huh. of mounting it so mm-hmm. that it's actually
very vertical. Heavy.
It is. Then we have another inscription. This one is in Greek, and maybe we could put the Greek class. We should talk to our Greek teacher and have their Greek class do some translating.
They can graduate
when they have finished this. That's exactly right.
So it illustrates the fact that though Rome was in charge and for legal reasons and so on, Latin was used, such as in this brick, yet culture still used Greek. That was still the dominant language, even in Roman times.
So what would we say about New Testament Palestine? We're moving away from the wider Mediterranean mm-hmm. for just a minute, but what mm-hmm. would we say about languages in use, like in Jerusalem? What would we expect to hear?
All three would be used. I mean, the army and the public servants would certainly use Latin. But Greek would be the language of culture, and various inscriptions would be used, and people would use it for writing, such as the New Testament was written in Greek. But the common people still spoke the vernacular, Aramaic. Religious would use Hebrew. So, and most people knew quite a bit.
Something
about,
at least enough to get along different settings.
Right.
And then we have a cooking pot. This is a standard part of our repertoire because mm-hmm. Kent likes cooking pots so much. And I guess that's because they are changing all the time,
yep,
and so it's easy
quickly.
To date them because the shapes are changing a bit, and so you can actually pin cooking pots down more tightly with time than you can with some of the larger vessels.
Quite well.
One's obviously been used on the fire because it's got a lot of soot on it.
Right. Yeah. And then a couple of necklaces from the Roman period, lovely necklaces provided to us by Audrey Schaefer, our own Dr. Audrey Schaefer, and some additional jewelry and a mirror from our collection. The handle is broken. Sometimes these are part of compact boxes. Mm-hmm. These are not new. What we do with makeup is not new.
Right.
It's been around for a long time. The Romans especially, I think, were good mm-hmm. at it. Mm-hmm. Although the Egyptians used a lot of makeup.
Think of Cleopatra, how she was doctored up.
Right. So, several things from different aspects of Roman life, which one could find in pretty much anywhere in the empire, mm-hmm. And we're thinking of the Mediterranean. So let's then think about context for the Roman world. We love to talk about context. When we find something, we lose its story if it isn't in context. Mm-hmm. So we like context. And we like to think about that historically and politically and economically and culturally too. So we will do that with the Romans, and we'll begin with the geopolitics. The Greek Empire, Kent, you've talked about this several times, and its size and extent.
It's really quite weighted to the east. We'll contrast that with the Roman Empire.
So then, what then does the Roman Empire look like?
That's weighted towards the west.
Right. And around?
Circum-Mediterranean.
The whole Mediterranean, isn't it?
Goes all the way up to the wall that separated Scotland and England, right. So Hadrian's Wall. And we also have evidence down in Judea of Hadrian's work. So they really covered the waterfront, we can say.
And it's nice to have Rome indicated there,
right,
with the red star, the white star in the red background, because that is central. Mm-hmm. And that certainly has a lot to do with why the empire went west.
It's interesting that cultures often spread across similar geographic zones. So clearly, Rome, arising out of the Italian countryside, favored that strip around, especially the parts that were heavily settled in France, were the more Mediterranean parts, in Spain, in North Africa. And that's where the Roman culture lasted the longest.
Now, the word, the term, Pax Romana, comes to my mind. Is it partly because they control all of this, that they finally could allow freedom of shipping, freedom of trade, freedom of movement? Is that what we mean by that term and its significance?
Sure. They put an end to piracy in the Mediterranean. That had been a real problem. Julius Caesar, in his younger years, was actually captured by pirates. Mm-hmm. He went back and got rid of them later, the very same ones. And they built roads that interconnected vast regions. So you had this imperial, actually determined activity that would pacify the countryside and allow trade to prosper, which led then to no wars within the empire to speak of for 200 years.
The phenomenon that we work with as archaeologists in the Near East is with layers upon layers, and we call them tells, sort of pyramid-shaped mounds of dirt, and civilizations are superimposed. This Pax Romana came about the time that these tells had gotten so high and so steep, with not that much, more land on top, that it allowed people, instead of trying to live in these walled cities, they could live at the bottom. And so Roman towns seemed to be built around these tells. And they thought, why not put a temple right on the very top so people can see it from a distance and so on. So that's the way we often find it now when we go to excavate the holy site, which would start out as a Roman temple and then turn into maybe a Greek, I should say Judean is what I was thinking of, Hebrew, and then Byzantine, and then an Islamic mosque. They sometimes go right on the top.
Especially sacred space.
Sacred space.
Seems to maintain its sacredness.
Right.
And later traditions will continue to occupy that.
And so this Pax Romana allowed people to live without walls at the bases of these tells.
Pax Romana also explains why, when we excavate, even in Palestine, Jordan, Israel, why there are so many imported goods, mm-hmm, because of the trade you were talking about, mm-hmm, and the ease of trade and the expansion of trade. Mm-hmm. So that informs us, and mm-hmm, it must inform our understanding of the New Testament. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We're living in a world richly supplied with lots of goods that have been imported.
In the Old Testament period, people hesitated to travel very far away from land, but in the Roman period, they got used to sailing easily across the Mediterranean.
Across national boundaries, and it was dangerous. In Rome, they were all in the same country. Mm-hmm. I was just going to mention about the food. Sure, Rome was fed from the surplus produced in Egypt, mm-hmm, the big grain ships that would come up and feed the people in Rome. Mm-hmm. I mean, Rome, the population had increased well beyond what we'd consider urbanism, to the point almost like that second generation of urbanism where the countryside around can't even support it. Mm-hmm. You need an outside source.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, then let's take a look at the people who populated the Roman leadership, the Roman emperors. And we begin with Augustus. Kent, say something. You teach you teach this in your Mediterranean class, and probably, I don't know if this sets up for your New Testament archaeology class, but we have a number of Roman emperors. We're going to walk through, we'll just look at them, and then look at some busts of them as well that would be influential, or at least partially influential, for our thinking about the New Testament world.
We mentioned the Pax Romana. It's really due to the genius of Augustus that the empire he founded lasted as long as it did. He was a political genius. The first leader that, looking back, Julius Caesar, that wasn't a general. He didn't really have the military persona either. He didn't need it. He was a genius, a political organization. It was certainly Augustus who established many of the political institutions which allowed the Romans to administrate effectively the whole countryside.
Okay. Then we go through and we think about some names on this list. At the bottom, Nero, a positive sort of image that we have of him or not?
No, he's remembered as the nutcase.
Right.
Part of it is his misfortune of being at the end of a dynasty, so of course the next dynasty wants to
capitalize
on that. But he was not fit. He probably didn't want to be. Initially, his mother was very hard-driven and got him into that position, and he didn't have those natural abilities that Augustus or Tiberius had. Okay. And so it was very hard for him to fill the role.
He was very anti-Semitic, too, and so certain Jews who became Christians wanted to sort of separate themselves from the reputation of people in his time.
And we might add that when Paul called his case to the Roman emperor, mm-hmm. which he could do as a Roman citizen, he had the misfortune that it was Nero who was emperor at that mm-hmm. time, mm-hmm. one not overly concerned with justice.
No, not in particular. Now, this particular slide gives us more of the emperors down through the end of the first century. Any names on here jump out that might be significant as we think about New Testament history?
Well, we were talking about the brick there with the 10th Legion and belonging to Vespasian and Titus who came along after him. And as you can see, AD 70 with the fall of Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple happened during their tenure.
Right, right.
And Domitian, the last one, is remembered for a persecution mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. with first rather profound persecution of the Christians. Mm-hmm.
And that sets the stage for the book of Revelation. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we need to be thinking about Domitian and his persecution as a backdrop mm-hmm. for the kinds of language, the kinds of imagery and so on, and the beastly mm-hmm. imagery that comes out mm-hmm. of the book of Revelation mm-hmm. would certainly connect mm-hmm. and everybody who listened to or read the book mm-hmm. of Revelation would make some fairly quick and easy mm-hmm. connections. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, a couple more that would take us into the second century, and that would be here with Nerva, I don't know, Trajan and Hadrian. What do we mm-hmm. know about them?
The next great war that the Romans had with the Jews was during the time of Hadrian, and he's known for having crushed them in Palestine.
Both of those emperors built a lot. The archaeologists and historians love them. Both reigned about 20 years. Mm-hmm. Trajan built a new highway down through the Middle East, mm-hmm. the Via Nova Traiana. Right. And Hadrian was remembered as the emperor who loved the East. And he actually made sort of a Epcot Disneyland area back in Rome where he had represented the different regions of the empire. Mm-hmm. But he spent a lot of time traveling in the East.
We would see Hadrian's Arch mm-hmm. at Jerash, a mm-hmm. Roman city. Mm-hmm. Hadrian shows up everywhere, doesn't he, in mm-hmm. terms of his architecture. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the brutal response mm-hmm. to, was it known as a second Jewish revolt? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The Bar Kokhba revolt. Mm-hmm. And that's where archaeologists make the division between early Roman mm-hmm. and late Roman. Mm-hmm. It's up to those years, 132 mm-hmm. to 135, and so we take that as the time period for making mm-hmm. the division.
Completely flattened Jerusalem. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And made it illegal for Jews to return there.
He laid out a new street grid pattern, which is actually the foundation of the old city streets today mm-hmm. in Jerusalem. And
it was called Aelia Capitolina, wasn't it?
Renamed it. He wanted to erase all old connections. Mm-hmm. And he built a temple over the site that locals said was where Christ had been crucified. And that wasn't removed until the time of Constantine. Mm-hmm.
A lot of activity we can attribute to him. A few pictures of busts, and I'm not going to spend a long time on these. Maybe I'll pause at one or two that we've mentioned so far. But there is Augustus, at least in one rendition, and another here. I'm not sure which hairstyle appeals to us the most. And some of these are looking alike, but how much can we depend on these depictions to be fairly accurate?
quite a lot. I mean, there are, the facial structure is relatively consistent across the board. Some are better representations or more skilled representations, but it is thought that they really do represent what the emperor, at least at some point in his life, looked mm-hmm. how he looked. Mm-hmm.
And we can find them for many of mm-hmm. the emperors. Mm-hmm. So if you look at Tiberius, Caligula thought to be the brutal one.
Off his rocker.
And he too was mm-hmm. problematic. Claudius, there's Nero, mm-hmm. For people who want somebody to look
he's
at.
Got the whiskers going there.
Well, yes, and that is quite unusual for mm-hmm. the depiction.
Hadrian did too.
Okay, all right. Galba, Otho, I guess mm-hmm. that's how one would pronounce it. There might be a better Latin way to do it.
These guys were minor, three or four mm-hmm. of them in 1 year.
That's right. Some of them, a very short stay.
Right before Vespasian, then he established.
And then Vespasian was there for quite a while. This is the one we need to think about with the assault on Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. And Domitian, who created so many problems for Christians mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. toward the end of the first century. And then Trajan we talked about, and Hadrian, there is the other bearded one. And again, some images of people that we're going to be thinking about, we read about, they're part of the history that prepares us for the New Testament world in Palestine.
There are three large bronze heads of Hadrian. One of them found in Israel and is in the Jerusalem Museum. Another one is in France, and the third one is in Britain, so you have to visit those major museums to see them all. Yeah.
Inscriptions. We have a couple inscriptions on the table. How widespread were Latin inscriptions?
Look how well it maps the empire.
It's pretty close to the whole empire, isn't
right,
it?
Right, right.
So how does this compare, Larry, to a map we might put up there of Iron Age inscriptions? We've been talking about these with the Old Testament books. How would this compare to that map?
Well, many fewer inscriptions in the Iron Age, certainly. We think that that handwriting or letters were not as popular in the Iron Age, but certainly over most of the Mediterranean world, you can find inscriptions right. from the Iron Age.
Maybe yeah. not to this extent.
Not to this extent, no.
And here's a particular one, Cicero. Who is Cicero?
Oh, the great orator of Rome, mm-hmm. a senator.
So we have a papyrus piece here dedicated to him. And this one now to North Africa, to mm-hmm. Libya, an inscription in both Latin and Punic. What is Punic tied to?
That's Phoenician, but it's the later version of it. It's contemporary with.
And Phoenician is kind of the parent language of Hebrew and a lot of the Semitic mm-hmm. languages.
Right. It's
but then it
a cousin.
Changes over time as well as mm-hmm. Hebrew and its derivatives change. Mm-hmm.
It and they're the ones that introduced the alphabet to the Etruscans and the Greeks and the Romans.
Another kind of inscription found where?
In Egypt.
In Egypt. Nag Hammadi.
Nag Hammadi.
In a jar.
In a jar.
In a jar. So what's important about this? It has the word gospel, okay. But besides that, what's important about this text?
A lot of the texts found at Nag Hammadi are from Orthodox Christianity's point of view, rather heterodox, and they illustrate the variety of Christian views that existed in the Christian mm-hmm. period right. at that time.
And this one representing Gnosticism?
Gnosticism. Mm-hmm.
A fairly large collection of
right.
texts,
right.
and Gnosticism being fairly influential mm-hmm. As the New Testament develops, and as people are trying to think about how do you define the Jesus person, partly God, partly human, hidden God, tucked away? Where? How does one think about this only appearing to be, as in Gnosticism?
The idea that it was the knowledge, the inside information that was important, didn't focus on on Jesus' death and resurrection in the same way that standard Orthodox Christianity did. So it was a very different way of approaching the meaning of Jesus.
Right. So some other sorts of things that we want to think about. Technology, so we have some engineering and construction illustrations.
You know, getting water around the empire.
Getting water
was
around.
Was a major issue, wasn't
it? We don't think about it too much because we get it around by turning on the tap. Not quite so easy in ancient times. And so we'll be thinking about several things, religion, literature, daily life. And we'll do so fairly quickly. What is this? I think everybody could imagine or remember this from any travel log.
Still visited in Rome, a major...
But we might make the connection that with the new understanding of an inscription, it was largely funded by the plunder from the temple in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. This has been reconstructed, and it's very interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I've discovered about Roman architecture when compared to Greek is that the Greeks were extremely inventive. Mm-hmm. The Romans tended to put... to do more with what the Greeks had invented. Mm-hmm. And they expanded much more, and they built a lot more. Mm-hmm. But it seems to be that the genius for a lot of the architecture comes from the Greeks. Mm-hmm. One might think about that, though, as one looks at this. Some characteristics noted here with roads, layered and sloped for runoff, the use of arches and dams, and the practice of Romans expanding and remodeling roads. Mm-hmm. They were very busy as engineers. We're not sure about this date, Kent. What might be the problem with this slide's date?
The terminology AC, we don't know where that came from, probably a typo.
Now BCE is often used for before the Common Era, so it would be the same as BC. Right. But ACE, maybe there's an attempt or some typo that got the A from AD together with the CE, we're not sure. Or maybe this is another way, maybe a specialized way, of indicating time AD. But what do we know about art? Couple of points here. Power and wealth. Don't all emperors do that? Isn't that part of the
projects
reason you have?
Power.
Projects mm-hmm. power. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, a long history of Roman art. Religion, a kind of a funny slide here. But talk to us for just a minute, Kent, about religion.
Well, Roman religion, the classical religion, was polytheistic. And so it was no big deal to identify your gods with another country's gods. And we have that between the Greek and Latin deities. But to say there's only one god, that was problematic. They tended to think those people were not very religious. They only had one god. But also there was the issue that if those people didn't at least sacrifice to the emperor, they were also treasonous. Mm-hmm. So there was this complete disconnect, misunderstanding between the traditionalists and the Roman establishment and Judaism, Christianity.
Good. Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Kent. And thank all of you for joining us for this edition of Excavating the Bible. We hope that we've provided something for you to think about and something to increase your faith. And we look forward to until next time. Until then, think ancient, keep believing, and keep exploring. For Excavating the Bible, I'm Doug Clark.